Hi, welcome to this lesson on buffers. It's a recorded lesson, okay? So we're going to be looking through the expressions. We've already looked through that in part one, and we're going to revisit these two ways of either calculating pH or calculating hydrogen ion concentration from pH. We're going to be reusing them. Use the expression for the ionic product of water, if you recall, and that is this. The product of hydrogen ion concentration and the hydroxide ion concentration in a sample of water will be 1 times 10 power minus 14 mole square dm to the power minus 6. And this is a constant number that we're going to use. This does not change whether you're looking at acid or alkali. In case of acids, you have more of this and less of this, vice versa for alkali. That'll be more. And the hydrogen ion concentration will be less, but the product will always be 1 times 10 power minus 14. So we're going to be looking and using this. We are also mainly looking through how to calculate pH for buffers. Okay. We'll also be looking at Henderson-Hessel-Balch bulk equation for pH. You can also look at and appreciate the relation between pH and the pKa using this. Just a reminder, these both equations are the same. We did look through that in part one. However, the plus and minus, beware of that in where you have the conjugate base in the numerator, you have plus. So remember one of them, okay? So if you have a minus, it's the other way around. So this has gone to the top and the conjugate base come to the bottom. The concentration of the acid has gone to the top. So beware of that, the minus symbol and the format of that equation. Many thanks to Lee Francis number 5, Lee Francis 5, who shared this amazing resource, the PowerPoint, as well as all the problems in the content that we're going to use today. Thank you so much. Just to recall, Ka for water, water being an amphoteric substance compound, it can behave as base as well as acid. As you can see here, two water molecules, one of them has accepted a proton to become this, and the other one has lost a proton to become hydroxide ion, right? So one of the water molecules has acted as an acid, and the other one as a base. So we have this equilibrium for water, Ka equals H plus and OH minus, and then you have H2O at the bottom, right? The concentration of water is always a constant, and you can work that out for any given volume. I think we did go through that in part one, so just a quick reminder. So if you have a certain volume of a solution, for example, right? Say 0.2 dm cube, that's 200 centimeter cube, right? So we have 200 centimeter cube of some solution in here. Let's say that is an acid solution, a weak acid, right? So we have a weak acid in that solution, right? So if you think about this, most of the solution is made up of water, right? So we can pretty much approximate that the 200 centimeter cube is the volume of water is actually 200 centimeter cube. Now convert that to mass, that's 200 grams because the water density is 1. Okay, so the volume in centimeter cube will be equal to the mass in grams, right? Now if you work out the number of moles of water in 200 grams, that will be 200 divided by 18, being the formula mass of water. That gives us, so here you have the number of moles of water, which is 11.1. So the concentration in 200 centimeter cube of water is the moles of water divided by the volume. That gives me 55.5. You can try this with any volume of any solution, any aqueous solution. We're assuming that the whole volume is just water. Okay, the volume occupied by any other substances in it, that's reacting substances, is very small. So we're going to assume the whole of this is water as an approximation. So you can also see that even during the reaction, the water is produced, or water being a reactant, the volume and the concentration of water does not change as much because the bulk of it is water, okay? So if it changes, it'll be like 55 point, a little bit less or more. So that's why what we do is we incorporate that into this and we multiply that across because that's the constant. This is a constant always at constant temperature. So that combined together, we use one constant and name that as Kw, the water, the ionization potential of water, okay? So that's H plus and OH minus ion, and that gives you a value of 10 to the power 1 time 10 to the power minus 14, as we have seen over here, right here. 1 times 10 to the power minus 14. So let's keep that in mind. So that value, we're going to be using this value. So in acidic solutions, you have high concentration of H plus ion compared to OH ions, right? So however, so if this increases, that decreases proportionally, and then you're still left with this, right? So even if you're looking at an acidic solution, that's true. Neutral, it is equal, but still you multiply them two, you get this 10 to the power minus 14. So in a neutral solution, you have H plus ion concentration equal to the OH minus concentration, which is going to be a square root of this. Yeah, so that's going to be this. Okay, so in alkali, you have less of H plus ion and more of this OH minus ion, and that you have an alkali, but still this holds true. You multiply them, you get this ionic product of water. Okay, so let's have a look at buffer solutions, how they work, and how it is different to just the acid system and Ka that we've been looking through. So buffers essentially have a huge concentration of weak acid, a larger concentration of weak acid here, HA, and also we have the salt, the conjugate base of the weak acid. Okay, this may look very similar to the weak acid equilibrium that we've been looking at so far. So here is the weak acid and its conjugate base. Now, the only difference between the weak acid equilibrium that we've been looking through and this is that you have a large concentration of this, and this is no longer equal to this because this is going to buffer systems do have added salt of the acid, right? So you have a good large concentration of this acid and a large concentration of the salt. Now, if we just consider a weak acid, this, the concentration of the conjugate base would be equal to this. That's no longer the case. Now you have a different concentration of this. So this, the concentration of the conjugate base, which is the salt, we can consider this part as the salt of this, is no longer equal to the H plus ions, right? So you have a different concentration. This can be controlled, so we can achieve the pH that we want. So a buffer solution essentially contains weak acid and its salt. So a buffer contains two independent reservoirs, I've just said. You have a reservoir of the acid, a huge concentration of the undissociated weak acid, which is the same as just the weak acid that we've been looking through so far. But then you have a reservoir of the salt as well, the salt of this weak acid. Okay, so these two, you need to really keep that in mind. So that is how what it's made of. What does it do? It actually minimizes any small pH changes, right? So it actually keeps medicines and things like that, creams, products that has to keep the pH constant for a period of time. So this is what it does. The buffer solutions actually keep the pH stable, not changing as much, and it kind of absorbs any changes in pH and small additions of acids and alkali. It actually has a mechanism of absorbing the change and keeping it pretty much constant. Okay, so that's what buffers actually do. How does it work? So let's have a look at it actually works with the reservoir of the weak acid, the concentration of the weak acid and the salt. So these two play a crucial role in keeping the pH the same. So let's have a look at how does it work. So when you increase the remember Le Chatelier principle as well, it's applied here heavily in explaining how a buffer works. This is a standard exam question. They ask you, give you a buffer system, and then you are asked how it actually works. So make sure that you understand this. We are looking through a general case. That's the weak acid, that's the salt, and that is the H plus ion concentration produced by the dissociation of the weak acid, okay? All right, this is produced by a salt. We'll look at what that means in a minute, right? So this, let's just see how it works. If H plus ion increases, apply the Le Chatelier principle. So if you increase this, the equilibrium will shift to the left, because that's what it says, the equilibrium shift in a direction to minimize that change. So in a sense, what you're talking about is you're just adding H plus ions to a buffer system. So you have a solution which is controlled, has got a stable pH controlled by a buffer. You add a small amount of acid, the buffer system actually removes that added H plus and brings it back to the original pH, close enough, very close enough. So the pH change is very insignificant, right? So that's what it does. So you can pretty much see how that works. You increase this, then it reacts with the large amount of A minus and then brings it to the left. Sometimes it can be confusing, so just focus on the H plus ion. What happens is the H plus ion will help you decide on the equilibrium shift. You increase this, that's going to shift to the left. Now let's have a look at the other case, right? So what happens if you add an alkali to this? You add an acid. If you add OH minus, again, focus on H plus. This OH is going to react with the H plus. Now that's going to decrease. So the H plus is going to decrease because OH is going to react with the H plus. So that decreases. Now apply Le Chatelier now. Now this is going to move to the right to replace the lost H plus. The H plus is going down. According to Le Chatelier, that has to be replaced. So the equilibrium shifts to the right this time. Okay. When you're asked, if you're asked about this in the exam, you have to talk about the equilibrium shift direction correctly. Now for that, thinking about just the H plus actually helps. Sometimes it can be confusing as to say H plus. You can also say the added alkali reacts with this, right? So this means this should go down. This leads to confusion, right? So I suggest for deciding the equilibrium shift, just focus on this bit here. Is it going down or up? If it is going up, it's going up, the equilibrium shifts to this side to bring it down. And if it's the other way around, so if it is going down, the equilibrium shifts to the right. So to decide that, that's really helpful. And then the explanation, you can say, okay, if it's going to shift to the right, you are adding alkali. That you can explain this just with the H plus ion. H plus ion reacts with the added alkali, so the H plus ion concentration decreases, so the equilibrium shifts to the right to replace the H plus ions. But what that essentially means is this acid, weak acid, will dissociate more to replace the H plus ion you just removed. And that's the effect of adding alkali. Now this can also be explained as added alkali reacts with this, and the equilibrium shifts to the right. Many students do get confused about this. Like, okay, if you're adding alkali and that reacts with that one, that concentration will go down, wouldn't it shift to the left, and so on. I think to keep it simple, to keep the to think about the equilibrium shift, just focus on that, right? Okay, so let's have a look at an example of how the buffer system in the body, which is in the blood, actually helps to maintain a constant pH in the blood. Okay, so buffers help maintain. Blood must maintain a pH of 7.4 to 0.05, right? The buffer system that we have is the weak acid, carbonic acid. So the carbonic acid dissociates, ionizes like so. Here is the conjugate base that we're talking about. So this is the ion or conjugate base, the ion of the acid. So after it's given up the proton, right? So this is the system we have. In, you know, if the pH becomes too low, which means you've got too much of H plus ions, then it results in acidosis, right? It's a condition which causes fatigue, shortness of breath, even death. Okay, so this is a really bad situation when you have too much acid. Now the blood fortunately can actually combat any increase in the H plus or alkali for that matter. So we look at both how the blood pH system, this system actually helps. There is also another thing that happens. The production of carbonic acid, we'll come to that in a minute. So that is the carbon dioxide level in the blood can react with H2O water to produce carbonic acid. So if you look at this H2CO3, carbonic acid is can be produced by an increase in the carbon dioxide level in the blood by respiration, right? So then if you increase this, then it's going to shift to the right to produce more of this, right? Okay, so it's like in linked system, but focus on this for the moment. Okay, so let's have a look at this original buffer system of carbonic acid and this. Let's just focus on what happens when you have the body producing too much H plus ion in some process. Okay, so if H plus ion concentration increases, remember to we need to talk about the shift. You're gonna shift to the left. Why? According to Le Chatelier, if something increases, the shift will be to bring it down. So if this moves to the left, producing H2CO3, then obviously it'll bring it down. So then you can think about, okay, that has to react with that one to move to the left. Okay, so H plus ion reacts with HCO3 minus to move the equilibrium to the left. Okay, so first thing that you decide is, okay, this is increasing. Just focus on that one, H plus, and which way the equilibrium shifts. And then you decide on, okay, which one is going to react with. Now you can then decide, okay, that's going to react with HCO3 and the equilibrium moves to the left, bringing, so the effect of that move, that kind of mechanism, is to actually bring it this down to the original level. So where we started off with, right? So after that shift, it's come back to the original level, right? Now, what happens if you have the other way around? So if the acid level continues to rise, the pH will fall. Then you know all of this. We don't have endless, you know, the huge concentration of HCO3 in our system. If it is too far low, then your buffer system will not be able to cope and function, and that will lead to acidosis. Okay, so this is not like a buffer that we can make in a lab or in a commercially made buffers. This is the buffer that's in the blood. There is not a huge amount of HCO3 ions. So if it falls down by too far, then it results in acidosis. Okay, so let's have a look at a situation where you have too much of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, where you have combustion happening in an enclosed space. Combustion will increase. So explain this physiological effects of burning fossil fuel in an enclosed space. So consider something like lots of Bunsen burners being used in lab and the windows are not open. So you have an enclosed space with not a lot of exhaust means. Then what happens? The carbon dioxide reacts with the water in the blood, producing more carbonic acid. So we are looking at this equilibrium, but producing this. Okay, let me just write that over here. So you are essentially looking at this situation where you are reacting CO2 plus H2O producing this carbonic acid. It's another equilibrium here, which actually increases the carbonic acid level. When it increases, Le Chatelier, according to Le Chatelier, that should shift to the right. Yeah, so that shifts to the right. Then H ion concentration increases. That will react with the carbonic acid system to bring it back this to the H2CO3. But this keeps on increasing. That means the equilibrium keeps, there is more of a shift to the right. Okay, so as long as you're increasing the carbon dioxide level in the atmosphere and breathing it through the lungs, diffusion happens and goes into the blood and makes more carbonic acid, you're going to keep on increasing this. This, you do not have a huge concentration of HCO3. So the blood buffer system will fail, and that results in acidosis as well, right? Acidosis and death, shortness of breath, shock. All right, all of that can happen. So that's how the blood buffer system works. Okay, so you can actually read this and see if that makes sense to you. That this is what we discussed, you know, like in special case where you have too much carbon dioxide, what happens? But you should be able to explain how this buffer system works. What happens if there is too much acid, H plus ion, being produced in the blood due to some kind of metabolic reaction? What happens? And if you're producing too much alkali, how the buffer system copes to keep the blood at a constant pH, okay? And we'll come back and do some calculations on this later on. Okay, two main ways of producing a buffer is adding solutions of a weak acid, just mixing a weak acid with its salt, the conjugate salt. Okay, so for example, the easiest one is ethanoic acid, weak acid, and its salt, let's say sodium ethanoate. Okay, CH3COONA, sodium ethanoate, can also be written like this, okay, in the ionic form. So you have the weak acid and its conjugate salt. It's just this ion and the weak acid concentration has to be sufficient and just a good reservoir of both of them. Then you have a buffer system, okay? So that's one way, just mixing, taking some of the acid and then the salt, mixing them together in a correct proportion to get the required pH. We'll look at how that works. Okay, so then you have you can just concentrate, because this is one way, acid, a weak acid to a conjugate salt. The other method is taking a weak acid and partially neutralizing by adding a strong alkali, right, to excess, to a required amount, right? So you're only partially neutralizing it, partially. So there is excess weak acid left. And then the salt is also made in that process. Okay, instead of adding a conjugate salt, you're actually making it by just mixing an acid with, reacting the weak acid with an alkali, producing that salt. Okay, so this will neutralize some of the acid to form the conjugate base. Pretty much the same thing, but here you're just taking a ready-made salt and mixing that with a weak acid. Here actually you're making the salt by the reaction of the alkali with the acid, right? Okay, so we are going to look through a lot of exam questions later on in part three, but for the moment, let's consider this. This is a good point actually to check your understanding on buffer, because it gets, we're going into the calculations, which is not the descriptive part of buffer, right? Ethanoic acid is a brown lauric acid. The student adds an excess of aqueous ethanoic acid to sodium solid calcium carbonate. The resulting solution is able to act as a buffer solution. Write a full equation reaction between ethanoic acid and the carbonate, right? So this is just an acid-based reaction. You should be able to write an equation for this, okay? So there is the equation here. You have the weak acid reacting with calcium carbonate, producing the conjugate salt. It also produces the conjugate ion, the conjugate base of this acid, CH3COO. If you want, you can put the sign, the charge here as well, but we have to be careful by putting the correct charge, right? So like that. So if you don't have to. Okay, so if you're producing this salt, some people do put the charge, but if you do put it correctly, okay? So that's this full equation for the reaction between this, right? This is not the main focus for us. So like any acid, but the carbonate, it produces the salt, carbon dioxide, and water. Okay, explain why this buffer solution has formed. So why do you have this buffer solution, right? Because you have a reservoir of weak acid, and this ion. I think it's best to just write down the symbol of the ion rather than trying to name it. So the ethanoate ion. If you can't remember that, you just write, we have this CH3COOH reservoir of this. Of this and this CH3COO minus conjugate ion in solution, right? Okay, so because we have these two ions this ion and the acid in solution, that is a buffer system. So we have a huge reservoir of this as well, right? You don't have to write reservoir, okay? But you have a good enough concentration of the salt, a good concentration of the acid, both in the system. That's why we have a buffer. One mark, that's enough. Okay, then we have this. Explain how this buffer solution controls the pH. This is 5 marks, so you need to really explain this properly, right? Okay, to explain how it controls the pH when either an acid or an alkali is added. You have to be careful in explaining this. You have to have 3 points in there. Number one, when it increases, which way the equilibrium shifts is the first decision to make. So I'm going to rewrite that equation over here. Okay, so I'm going to rewrite that here. Okay, so we have the acid here, and the conjugate ion of the acid is here. So you have the acid and the conjugate ion of the acid, conjugate base, right, of the acid is there. That actually comes from this salt. That's why I wrote that here. Okay, remember that salt. You have mix these solutions, right? Or you actually reacted calcium carbonate with this and produced this salt. So you have this salt in the solution, and this ion is all you have to really show. Okay, so try not to show the full equation and try to explain just the acid splitting up into two, just with an understanding this is not equal. Both of them are not equal because you've actually made a lot of this a high concentration of the salt. Okay, so keep that in mind. So you have that. I'm going to remove this, but this ion, the conjugate base ion, has come from this salt. Okay, so keep that in mind. Okay, so now you have to explain what happens when you have a high concentration of the H plus ion. So you increase this, right? So just focus on this. If you increase that, Le Chatelier says must come down, so the equilibrium shifts to the left. So the first point you have to say is equilibrium shifts to left, okay, or towards the reactant, okay. Then you think about, okay, how can that happen? That should react with that one, right? And then that should go to the left, okay. So say H plus ion reacts with the conjugate base, because you have lots of this. Some of that can react with the added excess acid, right? Little bit of acid, H plus ions added, right? Not too much. If it's added too much, then it will not work. So a small changes in the concentration of H plus ions, the buffer system can actually absorb it, bring it back closer to the original pH where you started with, right? So then this reacts with the conjugate base, shifting the equilibrium to the left, bringing the concentration of the H plus down to the original levels, and so the pH remains stable, closer to the original value, or with not much of a change. So 3 points to be made: equilibrium shifts to the left, H plus ion, what happens to it, say reacts with CH3COO minus ions. Just state the name of the ion rather than trying to name it. And then you say H plus ion concentration, okay, goes down. So pH stays closer to the original value, right? Original value. There you go, right? So that's the kind of explanation you need to come up with, right? Okay, I'm going to delete this, and then you need to think about what happens if you add alkali to this. Okay, so we're going to look at that. When you add, okay, so I'm going to just look at what happens with alkali, right? So let me just delete this. Okay, so this time around, what happens? Okay, so when you add an alkali, remember I said, just focus on this. If that will go down, so let's assume that alkali, added alkali is going to react with H plus. So if that goes down, so decide on what happens to H plus first, then the equilibrium will shift to the right to bring it back up, right? To restore the original concentration, according to Le Chatelier. So the equilibrium shifts to the right, okay? So first write that, equilibrium shifts to right. Okay, so do that first and then decide on, okay, how can that happen? If added alkali, that has to react with this is also acceptable, let's just say it reacts with the H plus. Okay, so added alkali or OH minus ion reacts with H plus ions, right? Okay, so bringing it down, so concentration of H plus decreases, and that's why the equilibrium shifts to the right. Or you can say this point first and then the second point, equilibrium shifts to the right to restore H plus ion concentration, right? So you're removing it and the equilibrium shifts to the right to restore it. That's an easy explanation, right? What is also accepted is the added alkali reacts with this acid, causing a shift to the right, okay? So added alkali reacts with this, shifting it to the right. Okay, then you sometimes people do get confused with that explanation. You can pretty much, you can actually explain that with just the H plus ion. Okay, so I suggest you just say, okay, if the added alkali reacts with H plus, concentration of H plus drops, equilibrium shifts to the right, that's enough. Okay, restoring the H plus ion concentration, so pH remains stable around the original value. Okay, so with that, you can actually look at the mark scheme closely to see how it is written there. That's the original reaction, calcium carbonate that produces the conjugate base of the acid. Good concentration of that, right? So as long as you can say solution contains the acid and CH3COO ion, you must say the ion, right? Allow ethanoate, calcium ethanoate, and ethanoic acid, so you can name them, right? So you have this as the explanation for why do you have a buffer system. You have both the acid and the conjugate base of the acid present, a high concentration of both of them, although it's not required for you to say high concentration. I hope that's understood, because even in an acid you do have these both. If you just have an acid, so it doesn't make sense, right? So if you just have an acid, you have this and the ion. Yep, so better to say a high concentration of the acid and a high concentration of the salt as well. Okay, that makes sense. All right, so that is that. And then you have other things, so you may want to pause this because I want to keep moving. So pause this if you want to read the explanation for what happens when you add acid, yeah, and then what happens when you add an alkali, right? Quality of written communication is really important here. All right, so pause the video if you want to have a look at the buffer system that we're going to move on. I'm sorry, if you want to look at the answer to the previous question, pause this. We're going to move on. This Henderson-Hesselbalch equation is really important for particularly calculations in buffers, right? These both equations are the same. Like I said, if you swap this around, numerator for denominator, then this sign changes. Okay, so this is the relationship between pH and pKa. Derivation of this equation is not important. Okay, so just try to remember this, and we can use this equation, right? Okay, so you have this equilibrium. So this Ka expression, KH plus plus A minus, you're familiar with this, right? If you just rearrange this, you get the H plus, and this Ka, this HA goes to this side. Okay, so that's here. So Ka multiplied by HA, right? And then A minus goes to the denominator here. So that goes here to the bottom, and that goes to the top, right? That's what you have here. HA has gone to the top, and then so you have an expression for HA. We rearrange this, right? So let me write that here just in case if that is confusing. A minus HA. Okay, so this goes over. That goes over to the numerator. Then you have that brought down to the denominator. So you have now that rewritten as this, right? HA. No, A minus goes here. A minus and HA at the top, right? So you have KA here, KA. HA at the top and A minus. So the point is that you can get H plus by rearranging it like this, right? This ratio is this acid concentration. That's a weak acid concentration that you have in the buffer solution. This is the concentration of the ion, right? Be careful with this. It's not the salt concentration, right? It's the concentration of just this conjugate ion. Okay, so concentration of conjugate ion of the acid, right? So be careful within the use of this expression. Okay, now this is actually the Hasselbalch. You can actually get the Hasselbalch equation from this. Really easy. Just take log on both sides. So log H plus. This is not needed. Just if you're curious, otherwise you can skip this step. H plus. Just do this really quick. Okay, log H plus equals log Ka, so log of Ka, and then at this when you see multiplication, when you take log, that becomes another log, log of Ha over A minus. Now multiplying the whole thing by negative minus, right? So what happens? So I'm putting minus log of H plus equals minus log Ka. Yeah, and then plus, sorry, minus log of Ha over A minus. Okay, now this minus log of H plus is pH, we know that, right? Minus log of that is pH, H plus, and minus log of Ka is pKa. Now you have minus log of Ha over A. That is Henderson-Hasselbalch equation, right? So why this is important? You can, there's a minus here, right? You can actually see what happens if this ratio changes, right? So if these two are equal, you get a situation where log 1 becomes 0 and then pH becomes equal to pKa. So we'll come back to that later on. Okay, so this gives you the ratio between this and this, and it's much easier to do some calculations. If pKa is given, you can work out pH if you know the ratio between the acid and the conjugate base. Okay, so that's how it's derived. Derivation is not important, but it's useful sometimes just to remember that equation, right? Okay, so let's have a look at the first example in the calculation part of the buffer solution. So far we've been describing what a buffer is, what equations are involved. Now we're actually going to use this to calculate the pH, right? So what is the pH of a buffer formed when 75 centimeter cube of that concentration of weak acid, 50 centimeter cube point to the solution of salt are mixed? So here you are actually mixing the salt of the weak acid, right? So first thing you need to do is determine the new concentration. Remember, the volume has changed now. You have 75 and 50, so the total volume is 125. So you need the new concentrations, right, of the weak acid as well as the salt. Okay, to work out the concentration, remember you need the number of moles. So see, I'm just using this N over V. It's the number of moles divided by volume, right? So you have that, that's the volume. So converted that liters here. And then this is the concentration, the original concentration. So I put that here, right? That's the volume. So that this gives me the moles of the acid that's present. You divide by the total volume. Now you have mixed both of them. So this 75 centimeter cube plus this 50 centimeter cube gives you 125 centimeter cube, right? Now that is written as in liters here. Okay, divide that by 1000, you get this. So you have moles divided by the volume. That gives you the new concentration of the acids. Do the same here, because you have 50 centimeter cube of the salt. Yeah, and then that is the concentration of the salt is 0.25. Multiply these two, that gives you the moles. Divide by the volume, 0.125. That's the total volume. So now you have the concentration of both. Okay, so you have the Ka expression to find. Oh, you have the concentration, the new concentrations now, right? So this is how you calculate the concentrations when you mix two solutions. Consider the total volume here and then the moles at the top, and you have the new concentrations of both the acid and the conjugate base, the ion there. The ion, the salt ion, the conjugate base is there, right? So then you consider this expression Ka equals this. Just write this down, and then you need the H plus. So if you have the H plus, you can work out the pH. Remember, our goal is to calculate the pH. So rearrange this equation, Ka. So this goes over here to the top, and then this A minus goes to the denominator. Like that, H A and A minus in that. So you've rearranged this. All you have to do is substitute this. So H plus ion concentration equals Ka is given here. So put the number here, 2.51 times 10 power minus 6 times you have H A ion concentration, which is 0.09, divided by the A minus concentration, the salt concentration is 0.1. And then just put the numbers in, work out the concentration of the hydrogen ions. So we have this value here, 2.259 times 10 power minus 6. So we have the hydrogen ion concentration. I'm sure you can guess the next step is minus log of H plus. That gives us the pH. Right, so then you do just do minus log of this number here, 2.259 times 10 power minus 6. So all I have done is put the numbers in for the answer for H plus ion concentration, and that's that. Normally it comes with one or two more questions, so you have to be really fast with this type of calculations, right? Once you practice this a few times, this can be done in a minute or 2 minutes. Okay, so this is an example of where you're making a buffer of a solution formed by adding 50 centimeter cube of an alkali to 50 centimeter cube of 50 centimeter cube of some ethanoic acid. Okay, obviously ethanoic acid is going to be in excess, and you're going to partially neutralize that with this, right? So work out the number of moles of sodium hydroxide that you have. So N of NaOH equals 0.1, that's the concentration of this, and the volume is 0.05. That gives you the number of moles. So always check if this is a 1-to-1 ratio. Okay, so now before you do any calculations, in this case it's a 1-to-1 ratio, so I just have to take away the moles of to find the moles of the salt formed, I have this, the moles of the sodium hydroxide is the moles of the salt. Then to find the acid remaining, I have to subtract this value, 5. So this value I have to take away from the acid, because that is how much salt being made from the acid, right? So I have to take away that from this, 5 × 10⁻³. So just put this in your calculator and look at the remaining number of moles of the acid. Okay, I'll take you through this calculation so far. We have the moles of the acid calculated here. Now you're going to, this is the original moles of the acid. Now you have to subtract the moles of the sodium hydroxide, because that's going to react. The number of moles of sodium hydroxide is going to react with that is here. So take away that. You're left with the number of moles of the acid that's left after the reaction. Mind you, the number of moles of sodium hydroxide is equal to the number of the moles of the salt here. Okay, so whatever you use here, that's going to be the salt moles. Okay, so to work out, now you have the number of moles of the acid, which is over here. So here you have the number of moles of the acid that is left now after the reaction. You also have the number of moles of the salt, which is here. Okay, so this is the sodium hydroxide moles, also the number of moles of the salt. Okay, so you have the both moles. Now you have to consider the concentration, right? Okay, so you have to just divide for acid, you take the moles and divide by the volume. Why do I put 0.1? It's because you have 50 centimeter cube of the ethanoic acid and 50 centimeter cube of the sodium hydroxide both added together over here. Okay, so you have the total volume of 100 centimeter cube, that's in liters. That's the moles of ethanoic acid by divided by liters. That gives you the concentration of ethanoic acid now in the buffer solution. Do the same with the salt, moles, volume. That gives the concentration of the salt. So I'm going to have to make some room for myself over here. So we have now the volume of both of them. I need some space to actually put this all into the equation for buffer. Okay, so I'm going to use this expression now for the Ka value. Okay, so H plus ion concentration would be Ka times the acid concentration divided by the conjugate base ion concentration, right? So that we have both now. Ka is here over here. So 1.7 × 10⁻⁵ times the concentration of the acid is here. 0.075 mole per dm cube, so 0.075 divided by the concentration of the salt, which is over here 0.05. Now calculate this. This gives you the hydrogen ion concentration, and from this you know what to do. Okay. Okay, so if you work this out, you're working out the concentration of the H plus ions over here, there. All of that gives you the hydrogen ion concentration. So you have the Ka here and the concentration of the acid, concentration of the conjugate base, and that gives you the hydrogen ion concentration. So now pH would be just minus log of this number, 2.55 times 10 power minus 5. There, so all I have to do is pH minus log of the hydrogen ion concentration, that gives you 4.59 is the pH of this buffer system. Okay, so sometimes you have to work out the proportion of the acid to the conjugate ion, right? So as in this case, going back to the blood buffer system, carbonic acid H2CO3, H2CO3. So we are given the pH of the healthy blood, Ka of this H2CO3 weak acid. How do we work out the proportion of the hydrogen carbonate ion to carbonic acid? So what the question is asking you to do is CO3 H plus hydrogen carbonate ion. What's the proportion of the hydrogen carbonate to this? So you can have a pH of this, right? So calculate H plus ion from the pH. So all you do is H plus ion equals 10 to the power minus 7.4, just using that pH. So you work out the pH as this, and then write the expression for Ka. That's the general form. Now if you just use this H2CO3 system, that will be like this, H plus HCO3 and this, right? Now rearrange this equation to get just this HCO3, and so keep these two because we need to know the ratio. Don't move this, just move this over here, right? So what happens is the equation goes like so: Ka divided by H plus ion concentration would be equal to your ratio, HCO3 minus H2CO3, right? Okay, or you can have, so you have the hydrogen carbonate to carbonic acid ratio, right? So hydrogen carbonate ion to carbonic acid ratio is this ratio. Okay, so let's put the Ka value here, 4.3 times 10 power minus 7 divided by the H plus ion concentration we just calculated here. So that goes here, 3.98 times 10 to the power minus 8. So now this gives you the ratio of HCO3, the hydrogen carbonate ion, to carbonic acid. So as you can see here, that gives me an answer of 10.8, and that means it's 1. So the hydrogen carbonate ion is around 11 times as concentrated as the carbonic acid, right? So if you want to write that in the ratio form, you should write like this, 11 to 1. Let's approximate that. HCO3 ion to H2CO3, they are in this ratio, 10.8 to 1, or you can say 11 to 1. Okay, it's actually practice time now. These are easy questions, tagged as mild. So have a go, pause the video, and then check the answer when you're ready. These are warm questions, like the middle level, medium level of hardness, so you can have a go at this. Okay, pause if you want to have practice of these, or but wait for the harder ones. Okay, so you can actually try these ones. Okay, because it will, which one will require the smallest proportion of salt from the buffer? Okay, so this is slightly harder, so I'm going to give you some idea about this. Okay, so from pKa, calculate Ka, like so, 10 to the power minus of the pKa value. Okay, then you want the pH of this, right? So from that you can actually work out the hydrogen ion concentration equals 10 to the power of minus 3.55, right? Then you are looking for the smallest proportion of the salt to form the buffer, right? So you're looking for, rearrange this, you get A minus HA. So I'm keeping these two on the right and then move this to the other side. So there you get Ka over H plus. Okay, so we're looking at this proportion of the salt to this. So whenever you get a question on the ratio of the salt to the acid, keep them both on the same side. Okay, and then you have the Ka over H plus, right? Ka value is here. So you can work out the Ka value and put that here. And H plus is here, right? So look for a smallest ratio, small number at the top and a really big number at the bottom, right? So that combination will have the smallest salt proportion of salt. So you're looking for say 1 to something like 7 as compared to 1/3, then this is smaller proportion of the salt compared to that one. It's 1/3 to 3 of the acid. Here is 1/7 of the acid, so that requires smallest proportion. Okay, so that's, you need to do that for all the 4 of them and then check. Pause to actually have a go. Check your answers for the mild questions that you tried. Okay, I'm going to move on, so you have to pause if you want to check this. That again, pause if you want to check here. Pause here if you want to check these answers, 2A and 2B. And these are the answers to the medium level questions. Again, I moved on too fast, I think. There, pause. 1, 2, 3. Pause if you want. Move on. Ah, this is the proportion questions. No, this is a different one. Okay, this is warm. Hot question, right? That's the proportion question of the salt to the acid. You can see the smallest proportion of salt is over here, 1/14. So pyruvic acid is what you would choose. So question number three in the hot area. What is that? Did not see that one here. Anyway, so I hope you can check these answers. And that is the end of this part two. The next thing is going to be like exam questions only. So see you in part 3.